reflect the work that's needed in today's regulatory environment. But I also believe that those costs are an area that we can work on improving. But my basic pitch to you at this point is do not underestimate the costs or the efforts required in these support services in either option. Please look before you leap. The third item is an offer. You know, a commitment, a request, and an offer. And basically, this is an offer to help. Help you with your collector portion of the sewer system, the part that is still the responsibility of the town to operate and maintain. As is included in your report, the collector system is an old system with deteriorating sewers and manholes, and we certainly share the recommendation of the report and the town's concerns that these sewers and manholes need attention. Repairs to those sewers and manholes would reduce the cost of treating the water that leaks in and doesn't really need treatment. One example, I did include, the last thing that I included in your handout was two photographs looking down two adjacent manholes. The first one is a manhole that's on the town system that shows that it, you know, distinctly needs some help and needs some is in need of some repairs. And the next, you can see some bricks on the ledge beside the trough, and see that the channel has been eaten away as well. The next picture is looking down a manhole. The next manhole just downstream of that particular one, which is the district's manhole. Our offer, item number three, is basically an offer to help you with your collection system and the needs at whatever level you wish. You have a lot of flexibility and to be able to help you do those much-needed repairs in the collection system, and which are also important for to help us maintain our system, because those bricks being left there could just wash down into ours and requires us to clean our system more frequently than we might otherwise have to. And also related to that, our costs, as we were going through the committee, I think it was very helpful to get some comparative costs of various different unit operations that we do and private contractors do. And over the course of those discussions, we found, certainly to our satisfaction, that our costs have been shown to be competitive with private contractors. So we offer to help you with your collection system. In summary, and in closing, we're willing to work with you. We're willing to be flexible in meeting our chartered obligations and your collection system needs. We're basically prepared to do so on into the future. In the vein of the look before you leap, I would like to invite you all on a tour of the district facilities. See what's involved before you consider your decision for the future. And we look forward to working with you in the workshop. But in the meantime, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a minute. Anybody got a question? All satisfied. Thank you. Appreciate it. Do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to move we acknowledge receipt of the report from the Sewer Ordinance Advisory Committee and refer this item to a council workshop.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Anybody got a comment? Yes, Councilor Dalbert.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to suggest that at that workshop, more detail be provided in two areas. One is listed as transportation under operations and maintenance cost, and the other is allocated charges to more specifically know what is that. The entire savings is in those two accounts.
Just a... The council earlier all did receive this book here,
mm-hmm.
which we didn't recirculate. To be honest, I don't know if those answers are in this book.
I don't remember them, but I don't know. I didn't go back to it. So
you may,
we need that and maybe need a better breakdown, for example, on allocated charges.
We have that in the annual district budget that they give us. It is a voluminous document.
Oh, thank you. I think it'd be a good idea. Anybody else? Ready to vote? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 7-0. Thank you. Appreciate you coming. And I want to thank the committee also. We'll be seeing you later on.
Just, if I may, that workshop is likely to be in May rather than in April, after we looked at some scheduling conflicts during the last 2 weeks of this month.
Item 126, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee recommending changes to the zoning ordinance, zoning map, and sewer ordinance relating to the proposed new town center zone and take any necessary action. I believe Councilor Coggeshall will open that up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What you have before you this evening is the result of the Town Council in August of 93 of accepting and adopting the town center plan concept. We then referred to the Planning Board for them to draft a town center ordinance, which they referred back to us. We workshopped in December, and this is the result of our discussion with a full council and many meetings of the Ordinance Committee. So I have a cover memo, which I'm going to read for you and then specifically cite the actual ordinance numbers. Our town planner, Maureen O'Meara, is not with us this evening, but Mr. Emery, I have a feeling, is still here for this item. Is that correct? It's not because such... Okay. After choosing to devote a portion of the state comprehensive planning grant to the town center, the town council created the town center planning committee in August of 91. This was an offshoot of the Main Street 1990 committee that was funded through Governor Kernan's administration to explore things needed in the town. The committee included representatives from the town council, planning board, school board, Main Street 90 committee, town center business owners and residences, and the community at large. All the meetings were open to the public and two public forums were held. The committee met over 20 times and submitted the town center plan, which included a draft town center zone in May of 1993 to the town council. The town council held a public hearing and adopted the town center plan as a component of the comprehensive plan. The town council specifically adopted the visions and goal statements, but did not endorse all of the recommendations which were to be considered by the town council eventually as the town center evolved. The town center also referred the town center zone to the planning board, as I mentioned earlier. After 1 year of reviewing and revising, including development of innovative design requirements, the planning board held a public hearing and recommended the town center zone to the town council for consideration in October 1994. We are also pleased to refer to the town center zone and the map amendments back to the council for consideration. In preparing the town center zone, some related amendments are also to be recommended, which would make sewer available to the town center zone and would restrict strip office development along major roads in the RC district. The Ordinance Committee remains committed to the concept of the town center as a mixed-use area, but has reinforced its primary focus as a commercial area by limiting multifamily dwellings to mixed-use buildings. It also added language that would prohibit adult businesses in the town center zone. All illustrations depicting on-street parking have been deleted, and drive-through facilities would be allowed for banks and car washes. The proposed town center zone is the product of an exhaustive planning process, and I'm sure my fellow committee members will emphasize that.
The committee chair got more exhausted than most.
Where public input was solicited and received at every stage. The concept reflects contemporary land use policies and research of techniques used in neighboring communities and nationally. The specific provisions of the town center zone have been tailored to fit the unique characteristics of Cape Elizabeth. And the actual ordinances proposed are 19.1.3, the addition of definitions for adult business, bed and breakfast, cottage industry manufacturing, farming, front setback, institutional use, personal service shop, banking, professional and business office, restaurant, village retail shop, and then Section 19.2.3, Resident C, prohibiting the use of conversion of homes to business or medical offices. Section 19.2.3.5 is the actual town center zone with purpose permitted uses, prohibited uses, dimensional requirements, non-conforming structures, sanitary waste disposal subsurface, design requirements, illustrations of what are compatible, incompatible, footprints, dealing with the scale of buildings, also with illustrations, the height and roof pitch, also with illustrations, building and parking orientation with design orientations, openings, exactly, which is sort of the rhythm of doors and windows, basically architectural standards, exterior materials, landscaping and site development, dealing with front setback. Front setback illustrations, and as you notice in the illustrations, we've removed the on-street parking. That can be dealt with at another time if it's found appropriate. Parking lots, buffering standards, building permits, and also shows a zone, which I have a small colored one up on our bulletin board over there that shows the present BA, RC, and RA that would be converted into the town center zone. We also are proposing changes in the sewer ordinance and in the actual zoning map.
That's it. Anybody got any comments, questions?
Yeah, that's a great job, Mrs. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr.
I had just one brief comment that all of the property owners who are in the zone itself are going to be receiving a packet that contains the entire draft ordinance. So that it'll save everyone coming in, as well as the new zoning map. Beyond that, we will send to abutters in the immediate area beyond that a summary of the proposal with a copy of the map.
Thank you. And I also want to thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. I hope we addressed some of your concerns. One concern we did address was that in this zone, the only satellite dishes that were allowed would be for municipal communications. And at the time we were having another meeting, we were having the controversy with Time Warner. And so we did amend that to allow certain dimensional reductions, but for other than municipal uses.
Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody got a comment one way or the other? Yes, Councilor Now.
I'd just like to echo the praise for Councilor Cogasol and all the work she's done on this, and also to add to that, thanks to the town planner, Marina Mara, for her work on this. I think it's a pioneer effort of sorts, and will serve the town well.
Thank you. I also want to extend that to my fellow committeemen who suffered many long meetings.
It's been an education.
What is your wishes?
It has.
What is your wishes?
My wish is that I set for public hearing on Monday, May 8th at 1995 at 7:30 in the town hall. It's getting late. A public hearing dealing with the new town center zone, the map, the related amendments to an ordinance, and the sewer service map.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any other comments?
No other comments. I have one comment. I'm going to vote in favor of setting this to a public hearing, but I do have a couple of comments, and I think my comments will come up probably too late when it comes to a public hearing, but I shall mention them as far as what is going to be done to the center. Everybody understand the motion? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. 7-0. Okay. You have a joke over there?
You should share it.
This is yours.
Item 127.
That's an extra one.
To consider a request from the Juan Prez for a sewer extension on Wells Road and take any necessary action. And to the council, as a property owner handed to the sewer, how it goes and where it goes, if it goes, I wish to step aside for this part of the council agenda, and I would ask Councilor Dahlback if he'd like to step into the chair.
Fine.
Do you all agree?
Yes.
But keep it moving.
Thank you. It's all yours, sir. I'll stand down back.
Mike, would you like to introduce this item?
Yes. Yes.
Hey, if you're chair, you can delegate.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd be happy to. Juan Perez, in his, I think, his own capacity, as well as in a corporate capacity, owns 211 acres of land up off Wells Road and Sawyer Road. As you can see from a letter you received from Terry Dewan, a landscape architect, on that we received on March 30th, they did request an opportunity to meet with the town council this evening to present to you the concept of a sewer extension. Beyond this evening, there are a number of issues that would need to be addressed. The exact capacity that's being proposed needs to be reviewed by the town engineer. That is now ongoing, as well as issues involving designation of growth areas, which you will need to address. And what it will be suggested once you have your appetite whetted by looking at this proposal is that you eventually have a workshop on this.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, if you could introduce yourself.
Thank you. My name is Terry Dewan. I'm a landscape architect representing Juan Perez. And with me tonight is Juan Perez, Amy Bell from my office, and Lester Berry from BH2M Engineers. And before you tonight, as you see in our letter of March 30th, is a formal request to extend the sewer to Juan Perez's property. And we have with us tonight an aerial photograph of the area. I know it's a little bit hard to see in red, an outline that shows the extent of the property that Mr. Perez has assembled over the last several years. He has approximately 211 acres of land that's bordered on the south by the Wells Road. It goes over to Sawyer Road. It goes back a considerable distance, close to 2,000 feet. The total property is made up of several different components. And we have indicated on here where it fits relative to the growth areas designated by the comprehensive plan. Comprehensive plan shows this area that's dotted, white dots here, as one of the major, if not the major, growth areas in the town of Cape Elizabeth. The entire area within this proposed subdivision is zoned residential A. Minimum lot size is 80,000 square feet. We have gone before the planning board on, I believe, four or five occasions. We've had a site walk with the planning board. We've had representatives from the Comprehensive Planning Committee, the Town Council, Conservation Commission, and Land Trust also go on site walks with us. We've met several times with the abutters. We also have the details of the plan that we presented to the planning board last week here tonight if you're interested in seeing it. I don't know how much detail you want to get into tonight. I think what we'd like to do tonight is to give you an overview of the proposal without getting into too much detail, but we're certainly willing and have that information available for you.
Excuse me, Terry, just maybe for myself, but I'm sure for some of the people who might be watching at home, could you point out a few features that will help people get a little better fix on exactly what this whole area includes?
The existing conditions as well as the proposal?
No, just to get okay. You know, right now it's a big circle for people, and I don't think...
North is up.
Hmm? You're right.
North is up. Here's the Spurwing River down here. Here's the Wells Road, goes over to Spurwick Road, over here, Spurwick Avenue. Here's Sawyer Road, going down through here. Elizabeth Farms was under construction when this photograph was taken back in the late 80s. There is a Central Maine Power Company cross-country transmission line that runs east-west through the property. Another notable natural feature, of course, is Jordan Pond.
Mm-hmm.
There is a drainage way that goes into Jordan Pond, extends partway out into the property. The town has a fairly large piece of land on the north side of the property, roughly 50 or 60 acres, I believe. Silva Drive forms one of the boundaries on the western part of the property. Mr. Perez's house is down at the very southern tip of the property on the Wells Road, and he has a house, a barn, and a garage there. Other than those structures, there are no other occupied structures on the property.
That's good. No, I think that helps position it in people's minds. Thank you.
In addition to this information, we also have a very extensive body of information, wetlands, soils, slope analysis, and so forth, which the planning board has seen. After going through the process of meeting with the planning board, looking at the net residential acreage, we feel that in the vicinity of 92 to 95 houses will be an allowable number of houses to be built on the property. And the planning board saw a presentation last week that showed about that number. And I say about because we're still in the process of working through the details. But that's, in ballpark numbers, roughly what we're looking at. There's also a very strong greenbelt open space component that you don't see on this plan, but it represents about 50% of the land. Roughly 100 acres of land will be dedicated as common open space, dedicated greenbelt. One of the special features about the site is the fairly extensive numbers of trails that run through the property. And I know that the greenbelt plan, as part of the comprehensive plan, calls for identifying trails and maintaining trails. There is a very active trail that runs east-west through the property. That will be part of the open space system. That represents about 8 acres of property. It branches into a very large protection area around the upper reaches of Jordan Pond. There's a 250-foot setback from that. All of which I think will be part of an integrated plan for this development. I think it's fair to say that this plan probably could fly without the sewer. This is not a project that's dependent upon bringing sewer out here. However, we feel after analyzing the site, looking at the soil conditions, that would certainly be a much better project because it would allow us to cluster the development, it would allow us to shorten the length of the road, it will certainly allow us to preserve a lot more open space and extend the green belt and the open space concept in a manner that we probably couldn't unless we had the sewer brought to the site. At this point, we have not done any calculations on the number of pump stations and any of the details, although Les Berry is here to address the procedures that we'll be going through to get those pieces of information. We have talked to Fred Morin at 2i Lynn to talk with him about the capacity of the treatment plant. At this point, we don't have any information from him, although Les Berry did today talk with Portland Water District. Apparently, the Cape South treatment plant has about 200,000 gallons of excess capacity per day. It's our initial impression that a development of this size would use about 17 or 18,000 gallons per day. Roughly about 8 or 9% of the available capacity would be allocated to this project. This project represents about 20% of the projected growth that was talked about in the comprehensive plan. And so it seems like, if anything, we're within the ballpark what the comprehensive plan anticipated when they talked about designating growth areas and anticipating future growth in these types of areas. We will be getting, hopefully, a certification from Fred Morin, eventually in compliance with the sewer ordinance to allow the council to act upon that request. We do feel that this meets the characteristics of the growth area. Obviously, it's outside of all the rural protection areas, with the exception of the green belt, which is this area through here. We are incorporating that into the plan. We feel that it's possible to have the on-site disposal. There is public sewer available. The treatment plant, of course, is right down here, and we're probably going to be running the sewer line up Spurwick Avenue and coming across on the Wells Road. And it is in rough proximity to established neighborhoods, as you can see from the aerial photograph. We're at a point right now where, in order for us to go ahead with our engineering and continued planning and going before the DEP and then back to the town planning board, we are going to have a decision from the council. This, I think, is one of the progressions of steps that we're looking to the council for in order to proceed. So this will turn it back over to you for questions.
Thank you. Questions? Silence is golden. Hearing none, thank you very kindly. Anybody else addressing this?
Good evening. I'm John Boomer from 9 Delano Park. Since the middle of March, when I've become much more familiar with the existing needs of ball fields in Cape Elizabeth, I would like to make a recommendation to the council that if a developer, such as the proposal that's on the floor, and I don't mean to blindside you folks because I haven't met you before, only read about this on the agenda tonight, is that it seems as if they would be adding, if their proposal goes through, a whole lot more families who might have children to the Cape. And if we already have a tremendous shortage, which I agree with the people who were talking earlier about a proposed ball field, that possibly in their development they try to set aside the roughly 3.5 acres that is needed for a multi-purpose baseball and soccer field. I'm not, again, I don't mean it specifically to have this project make up for all past omissions of this type of setup, but it sounds to me like a possible opportunity.
Thank you. Another gentleman?
Good evening. My name is Steve LaPlante from 1176 Sawyer Road. And I just basically wanted to get a better feel for the project that you're proposing. Good job acquiring that much property in one shot. You talk about sewage. You talk about household effluents. Are you talking about roadside drainage too? Roadway drainage?
That's not the issue tonight here, but we've always talked to the planning board about that.
Okay, because I'm concerned about site drainage too, because you're posting this on top of the hill where there are many households down through Sawyer Road.
This is not a review of their total plan. All this was a fast overview. There will be certainly meetings with the planning board and public hearings, et cetera, to get into a lot of the details, but I don't think the objective tonight is to try and to get into plan details. Okay. As a matter of fact, we're really primarily talking about a sewer extension tonight.
Where would the sewer be coming from?
Go ahead.
Treatment plant is down here right now, so we drain it probably up Spurbank Avenue and then down Wells Road. Okay.
Thank you.
Did I understand correct? I'm sorry, my name is Bob Tripler. I live on Trundy Road. Did I understand correctly that this sewage treatment plant that's over there has excess capacity? Is that what you're saying? Because I'm concerned about at what point does the town have to build a new sewage treatment plant because of this kind of expansion?
Michael?
Yeah, I'm glad you raised that issue, Mr. Tripler. The amount that was quoted by the Portland Water District as excess capacity is not the official town position. You know, I'm not too sure at what level anyone spoke to at the Water District, but it's the town engineer that determines the excess capacity based on existing use plus our engineer's consideration of possible infiltration. There are many different ways that you can judge what excess capacity is, so I would take that 200,000 as just one number that's been thrown out there that the town itself would need to have an official review of what the capacity is, but my sense is it's quite a bit less than 200,000.
And who pays for the extension?
Under the ordinance, the proposer, the developer, property owner pays for the extension.
Is there any possibility of including in I don't know whether it's an agreement with the town or whatever, that should that estimated capacity, excess capacity, be wrong, and we do have to build a bigger or improve or extend or whatever, that the builder is committed to making up that cost?
You know, we can document very, very close, because the district has all the records as to what the capacity is. The real question is, how much of that do we reserve for infiltration, for the peaks that happen during heavy storm events? You know, it's a separate issue as to, you know, we know pretty much from the number of homes, from looking at other homes, how much each home will put into the system. That's a given. What's not a given is the failure rate of the rest of our system.
Thank you. Any councilors have any other questions? Mr. Tom.
I want to grab you before you close public comment. Tom Emery, Chairman of the Planning Board. There was reference from Mr. Dewan of several planning board meetings. I think the council is fully aware of the nature of those meetings, but since it's a televised meeting, I'd like to emphasize that those are workshop meetings, that at this date there's no formal application before the planning board. The public has been invited to those public meetings and to the site walk, and at this point, once again, there is no application pending or any standing created by any of those meetings, and we're looking for a full application and review in the future.
Thank you, Tom. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a question of Mr. Berry.
Yes.
You showed up tonight. We want to make sure everybody gets their money's worth. There was an approximation of gallons per day that this development would add to the system. My experience is gallons per day for residential is based on number of bedrooms. Is that how you do your determinations, or do you use some other system?
In a subdivision of this nature, we'd probably use like 2.3 persons per house for an average, times 80 gallons per day per capita, and times, you know, 90 to 95 or something like that, homes. And that was how we got the 16,000-17,000 gallons per day.
Do you know how that compares with, I think, doesn't state plumbing code do it by?
Right, state plumbing code is a little bit different because they're trying to cover the worst case situation. If you were going to design a home with like three bedrooms, you may have 200 and I think it's 40 or 50, something like that, gallons per day. Okay. And that's to cover the worst case situation. Mm-hmm. And if we were going to have, you know, large homes or larger than average, you may go higher than the 2.3 persons per house also. But that data can be compared to what, you know, existing homes in Cape Elizabeth are using right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, just the numbers seemed low to me, and I understand why. Yeah.
Well, we would have a brand new system, so we wouldn't have the infiltration problem that the rest of the Cape system has in places. So we would be able to eliminate a lot of the excess flow that you're getting to make the average in other homes seem higher.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councilor Cogishaw.
I move that we set this to a workshop. Mr. McGovern, did you have a particular time in mind?
A date, no. There's some other issues involving scheduling of workshops, which I discussed with the council chairman today, okay. Which probably wouldn't be best to discuss at this point, but it probably will not be during the second 2 weeks of April.
You can have it that time if you'd like.
Last half of April.
He's not going to.
I say if you'd like to have it at that time, that's fine by me.
We can discuss it later.
Is there a second on the motion?
We will send notice out in the area to let folks know. When.
Any discussion on the motion? All in favor? Any opposed? 6-0-1 abstain.
You did a very good job, Mr. Holmes. Oh, it's a I didn't.
I mean it. Oh.
Okay, moving right along. Item 128, to consider authorizing the town manager to authorize a lease purchase agreement with CE Capital Public Finances Incorporated for the new fire pumper previously authorized and take any necessary action.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. This provides a first payment of $70,000 this year and then three additional payments of around $37,000. That includes principal of $166,565 and interest of $14,123.
Anybody? Yes. Council Delbert.
I'll move the agreement.
Second.
Any other comment? All in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Vote.
Is that a spending spree?
Item 129, to consider authorizing the proposed loan agreement for the Cape Elizabeth Light Second Order Fresnel Lens, maybe I screwed it up, from the United States Coast Guard and take any necessary action.
I've heard several different ways to pronounce it, Mr. Chairman, so that's fine. You're doing fine.
I'm not the only one.
Yes, this is the original lens. I wouldn't say the original. It's been the long-standing lens that's been up in the Two Lights Tower. The Coast Guard took it out. It's now stored at the Coast Guard base in South Portland. It would be on display here in the Town Hall lobby initially for a period of 10 years. It's fully renewable. These things are renewed quite regularly. It has an appraised value of $1.5 million. We would be required to carry insurance on it of $500,000. That insurance is proposed to come out of the Portland Headlight Fund, so it not be borne by the general taxpayer of Cape Elizabeth. We would have a little plaque made indicating that it's on loan from the Coast Guard, along with some other information about the lens. We're also having the original blueprint of the lens framed to go on the wall next to it, so that people can see the original blueprint, which is interesting to see. Beyond that, the Coast Guard, local Coast Guard, is very excited about this and has indicated that they will install it for us, actually put it in place, put a small light with it as well that would not be on all the time, but that could be controlled so that people could see it with a small light on to get the effect of a light. We would be responsible if they ever did want it back for hacking it and returning it, according to this agreement. Whether or not we would actually bear that cost, I don't know, but the agreement does provide that we would be responsible for it.
Mr. Chairman, I move we authorize the town manager to go ahead with the loan agreement.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody else got a comment one way or the other? Not? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. 7-0. Item 130, to consider approving the annual dog warrant and take any necessary action. Debbie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In your packet, you should have received a copy of the annual dog warrant. We are required by state law to notify all delinquent dog owners that their dogs must be licensed. Beginning on May 1st, there's a $10 late fee plus the cost of the license. The animal control officer will notify folks after May 1st. They have 7 days to come in. If they don't comply, we do have the ability to summons dog owners for unlicensed dogs. So I would ask that you sign the annual dog warrant.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilor Cogswell.
I move we approve the warrant is presented.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment? All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. Item 131, to consider approving the warrant for the May 2nd, 1995 municipal election and take any necessary action. Do I hear a motion? Comment?
I move we approve.
Second. And designate Deborah Lane as clerk of the election.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Vote. 7-0. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Anybody out there would like to make a comment? Yes, Mr. Ridge, yes.
John Ridge, Pleasant Valley Avenue. Would somebody explain the steps that are going to take place with your, I think it's like a workshop meeting you're going to have with the school board, how the public may participate, if they may, at that? Is that a committee? Is it the entire council? Is it the entire school board? Is it open to the public? Do you make recommendations? Can you take a vote? I noticed it was listed in the paper the other day, and I'm at a loss. It's been a few years since I've attended one of those.
The town council's finance committee, led by Chairman Dick Dalbeck, will be meeting on Wednesday and Thursday of this week. Wednesday involved primarily the school budget. Thursday will be a continuation, if necessary, on the school budget, as well as the community services budget, and then having a special town council meeting at which the finance committee will present reports based on its workshop and will set public hearings for May 8th on the budgets of the general fund, which is the town, school, community services, and county, as well as on some of the other funds, the sewer fund, the lighthouse fund, Spurwink Church, Riverside.
So are you saying the public can attend and they can ask questions?
Public can attend all meetings, and it's up to the chairman and the committee as to the extent of public comment.
Right. So there's no vote taken at that time in any one of those workshops?
Yes, the finance committee will vote as a finance committee to make a recommendation to the town council. The finance committee is a committee of the whole. Okay. They'll vote to recommend something to the town council. The town council will have a special meeting on this Thursday evening to set a public hearing for May 8th.
Okay, now, when the council meets with the school board, are they in a position to make any recommendations to the school board if an item comes up that they disagree with in terms of funding?
Council is always in a position to recommend whatever they want.
Certainly the council in the past has had some active discussions about budgets with the school board.
Okay, so if there are considerations or things that you wish to bring to their attention, and at that time say, we feel that this is an excessive amount of money that you're requesting for, can you ask them at that time to make an adjustment?
Yes, we can ask them to make an adjustment, but they are the people responsible for their budget.
I'm aware of that.
We do not dictate their budget, but we certainly have some influence over what gets presented in total as the overall budget of the town.
Right, I'm aware of that. I was just wondering the process where you would make your comments to them as opposed to getting to the public hearing, which normally seems everything's been taken care of and it's pretty much presented as it's going to be passed.
And it probably, hopefully, will be taken care of by the time, a lot of it by the time we get the public hearing, but there'll still be a public hearing.
Okay, good.
You may want to share some of your concerns or issues in writing with the council before that meeting. If you want to put something in writing to the council about a concern.
In reference to what?
In reference to the school budget, which is what I assume you're...
Okay, you're saying prior to the
But you may put something in writing to the council and give it to council members who will be there as finance committee Wednesday night.
Okay, as well as attend if I wish, right?
Certainly. They're all public meetings. Yeah, they're all public meetings.
Well, I attended a school board workshop, and there was an individual there that questioned the procedure as to how it was handled in terms of votes.
Yeah.
And I've done a little research, and I wish to pursue that.
Very good.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
I would go over what Councillor Coggeshall said, though. We do get a lot of input in writing from people who have specific concerns so that we have an awareness of that before whatever meeting it might be and whatever subject is being discussed. So if you have some concerns, that's a very good idea. McLaughlin. Sorry, I just mixed up the councilors, but that's all right. I'm consistent.
We'll deal with you later.
I'm consistent.
Yes, sir, go ahead.
Hi.
Sorry.
John Boomer from 9 Delano Park. I have a question about staff recommendations to the council. And I received a copy of the summary of recommendations from the meeting number 8 of 94-95, i.e. the January 9th meeting. And under item number 88 and 89, the bikeway pedestrian shoulders issue, it starts out, the staff has no recommendation, period. This is very much a policy issue, period. And then it goes into a bunch of questions. Can we afford bikeways, aesthetics, et cetera, et cetera? And in contrast to that, the issue that is very much on my mind, which has already been discussed tonight, I believe has come, or came much later in that that meeting, came very much with a staff recommendation. And I'm curious, does the council have any guidelines for what are the right situations for recommendations or not?
I'm not sure what the staff recommendation was that you're speaking of. I think it was to refer it off to closed. Let me read it so that there's no misunderstanding. Now I'm talking about on tonight's proposal that you're complaining that there was a staff recommendation.
No.
He's
not going
to
stand here.
No.
He wants to know how.
You want to know generally when the staff makes recommendations?
Right, and then specifically where on the bikeway pedestrian shoulders issue, it sounds like because there's a, quote, policy issue, it doesn't make a recommendation, but then on another situation, it does make a recommendation. And I'm wondering, you know, what makes them different and what are the guidelines for making recommendations?
I think on all of these things, there's a very delicate dance that goes on. And, you know, in some communities, councils say that's policy, stay away from it totally. Some places, the managers will say that's administrative, stay out of it totally. In this community, we tend to go over the line back and forth quite a bit, which maintains a healthy exchange and which I think enables everyone to contribute the skills and talents that they bring. I think that there's no exact rule to it. It's I think everyone tries to use their common sense and bring their best judgment forward for the good of the community.
Can any of the councilors respond to that question and or my concern?
I'm not too sure I understand what your concern is.
My concern is on one issue, the bikeway pedestrian shoulder issue, the staff said it has no recommendation and, quote, this is very much a policy issue. The issue I'm dealing with and my neighbors are dealing with is a proposed multi-use ball field, again, on town land, where one is assuming that the bikeway and pedestrian shoulders are also on town land. Why should that not be looked at as a policy issue of who should use Fort Williams, how it would be dealt with?
I think those are policy issues, and I don't think that I didn't see a staff recommendation on use, on who should be using things like that. I did not see a staff recommendation on the policy part of it.
No.
I saw a staff recommendation on some procedural matters, and that is something that I, as a counselor, do look to staff for assistance. And there are times, I think, when Mr. McGovern in particular reminds us that something is a policy issue and it's up to us to deal with it. I think it depends on the circumstances. That's how I deal with it, you know, to answer your concern, basically. It depends on the circumstances. I look to staff for factual information and sometimes options of different policies that we might want to pursue and think about. Mr. McGovern deals with this day in, day out. We're here one night a month to deal with these things. He, you know, has some longer standing experience than some of us sitting here, and you know, those are my guidelines.
So am I to take it that there are no guidelines from the town council as to when the staff should make a recommendation as to whether a project should be encouraged or It's only a policy issue, and so we're not going to encourage it or discourage it. And the specific one on this ballpark proposal is the staff helped the proposers write a grant to the state for $31,000.
If I might respond to that.
The council asked them to.
You know, the staff also met with you, has met with Mrs. Guthrie on three or four occasions, has offered to photocopy all the letters that Mrs. Guthrie has sent in. We try to be helpful to citizens as they come in with their issues. The particular grant application was one that, you know, did come to this council, and, you know, it might have been shortly after it was done, but the council specifically authorized it. I'm not sure what you're getting at, Mr. Boomer.
Okay. I'm getting at the very basic idea of fairness, of treating all citizens alike. That one group, just because they come to you first, gets treatment and help and assistance, and that it feels to us who did not get there first, because we didn't know about it, that we have to play catch-up and that we're not treated equally, I think is the very bottom line of it.
Okay, but I would like to cut this off.
Sure.
I will say that I think as far as the staff goes, in my opinion, that if we feel we need the staff, we ask them for something. If we feel that we don't, we move on with what we have in front of us and before us. That is kind of the way I look at it. Okay?
I hear you.
Could I say one more thing very briefly? Ms. O'Meara helped prepare an application. I have no idea whether she's for or against this proposal. I have no idea what her position is.
And it doesn't matter. It's her expertise in application.
So proposal. I think you're reading a lot more into it than you need to.
Okay, well, a lot of it has to do with the timing, which became very apparent tonight, where there seemed to be movements to move this project very rapidly, in contrast to most other projects that take not a matter of months, but a matter of years to pass through the system of the Cape. And we who are being affected by it don't want to difficulty or the inability to collect the proper information simply because of a time factor that's not our doing. We're not doing anything.
Okay, thank you. Maybe they was a little late in coming to you, but I think they were doing a very good job in hand by sitting down and meeting with you and let you know instead of waiting for you to come to a public hearing. I think that's, you ought to commend them for that.
I agree with you.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? We have one more item that was just slid in front of me here. That Item 132, consider entering into executive session to complete the annual evaluation of the town manager and to receive an update on collective bargaining with the Cape Elizabeth Police.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Now we can adjourn.
To the room to the rear.
To the room to the rear.